الكتاب المقدس قصة فريدة ليس فقط عن علاقة الله بالإنسان، وإنما عن المسيح ابن الله الذي صار إنساناً ليفتدي الإنسانية ويغير الإنسان ليصير مشابهاً لصورته. على قلتها هذه الكلمات تدفع بآلاف الأسئلة إلى الذهن، ومن خلالها ربما آلاف الاعتراضات. بداية، هل نصوص الكتاب المقدس تحوي هذه القصة؟ وهل هذه القصة تعكس وقائع تاريخية؟ هل بإمكاننا أن نقول أن الكتاب المقدس هو حقاً كلمة الله؟
إيماننا المسيحي مملوء بالحقائق الصعبة، في أشياء ليست سهلة الفهم. فنحن نؤمن بإله واحد ثالوث أقانيم، نؤمن بأن المسيح هو الله وإنسان، نؤمن أن المسيح على الصليب حل مشكلة خطايانا. هذه الحقائق اللي بنرددها كمسيحيين ببساطة ليست بسيطة بالشكل الذي يتصوره البعض، لكن الحقيقة مملوءة بأشياء معقدة ويصعب فهمها. وده بيخلينا نسأل السؤال، لماذا كمسيحيين نؤمن بما نؤمن به، ولماذا نعلم بما نعلم به؟
الكتاب المقدس هو كلمة الله إلينا لكي تنير وتشجع ضمائرنا أن نعيش وفق مشيئة الله. من أجل ذلك هذا النور الإلهي الذي يأتي من الكلمة ينير الجوانب المظلمة في الضمائر البشرية لكي ترى بوضوح كيف تسلك في الحياة.
These words contain the very breath of God.
لم يكن لأي كتاب في تاريخ العالم المتطور تأثير مثل تأثير الكتاب المقدس، بدءا من هندسة المباني إلى هيكلية أنظمة الدولة. هذا الكتاب كان مصدرا لتشكيل وجهات النظر لملايين الناس على مدى 2000 سنة تقريبا، ولا يزال يعتبر من أكثر الكتب نشرا وقراءة ومصداقية في تاريخ البشرية. لقد صرف العلماء قروناً يبحثون ويقيمون دعواه. فهل هذا الكتاب الذي يقرأه الملايين من المؤمنين المخلصين ويطيعونه ويضعون رجاءهم عليه هو حقاً رسالة الله لكل البشرية عبر كل الأزمنة؟ وهل يصادق العلماء المعاصرون على ما ورد في الكتاب المقدس من إعلانات؟ أم أن ما شهدناه من تأثير دعوته هو أكبر عملية خداع في تاريخ البشرية؟
How do we know if these things really happened or not? Matthew and Luke proclaim that Jesus is virgin born. But come on, none of us know anything about virgins who have babies.
The mystery, this book, how the hell it was made, why we preserved it, how it happened to motivate an entire culture for 2,000 years and to transform the world.
قد يتساءل البعض ما إذا كان تأثير وملائمة الإنجيل لروح العصر هما مجرد حقيقة من الماضي، إذ لا يمكننا أن نتجاهل أنه بدءاً من عصر الاستنارة إلى نهاية القرن 18 نحن نشهد تضاؤل تأثير الإنجيل في الغرب وربما تناقص عدد المسيحيين في الشرق. لكن قلة شعبية الإنجيل أو حتى تضاؤل تواجد المؤمنين في منطقة معينة لا يعنيان بالضرورة انعدام تأثيره، كما أنه لا علاقة بين موضوع ملائمة الرسالة وغياب الشعبية.
It's outlasted kingdoms, many kingdoms. You know, it's really interesting that turns out that a book is more durable than stone. It's more durable than a castle. It's more durable than an empire. And that's really interesting. You know, that it's something in some sense so evanescent can be so long living.
ربما سبب ديمومة نصه يكمن في قدرته على التجاوب مع احتياجات الطبيعة البشرية وأحدث تغيير إيجابي في حياة الذين يعيشون تعاليمه.
The themes of the Gospels are the issues that Christians and others face in every century and every era of human history.
Even people that have been raised in different cultures, even people that have been raised in different religions. They read these texts and something rings true. They say, yes, yes, indeed, this speaks to me. And the more they study it, the more academicians and scholars study these texts, the more they discover how they hold together. They speak the truth about the human condition, and they tell the truth about who God is.
بالإضافة لاحتفاظه بأهميته الروحية والأخلاقية حتى عصرنا الحالي، لا يزال حضور الكتاب المقدس ملموساً في الكثير من المجالات الاجتماعية، حتى في بعض المجالات حيث التزمنا الصمت ولم نعلن الحقيقة.
It's foundational to our culture. So if it isn't relevant, it's because we don't understand it properly. That's not good. It's not like the Bible has become irrelevant and people just continue to go on the same way. That isn't how it works. Is that if we can't make a connection with our past, then we become unmoored.
It has been the biblical faith that has given rise to many of the things that we take for granted, that has taken millennia to bring to this point.
The articulated structures of a culture, its body of laws, let's say, are predicated on something underneath that that's a narrative, it's a story. And that story is predicated in turn upon a set of metaphysical assumptions. You can't expect the formal structure to remain intact when the story disappears and the metaphysical assumptions are decimated. It'll fall apart.
In Western systems of justice, there is a principle called in Latin, respondeat superior, which means, roughly translated, the master is answerable. An employer can be held, and this is the term in the law, vicariously liable for deeds done by his employee in the service of his employment. This is a very common feature of Western systems of law. So it seems to me that this principle of vicarious liability is extremely close to the notion of the imputation of our sins to Christ and his bearing the punishment for those sins in our place.
عندما نرى هذه التأثيرات العميقة للكتاب المقدس على المجتمع، لابد أن نتساءل عن نوعية هذا الكتاب. كيف وصل هذا الكتاب إلينا؟
We're talking about a handwritten document, not done after the time of the printing press on a printing press. A handwritten document, all of them are unique. Every one is different from the others. Secondly, a manuscript could be as small as a small fragment, like P52, our earliest New Testament manuscript, as I've said, about the size of a credit card. But the average sized New Testament manuscript is not just a small fragment. The average New Testament manuscript is more than 450 pages long. So they're a good size. And even the earlier ones are quite substantial.
When you turn to the question of transcription, they have been copied over and over again, more than any book in the world. They have been translated into more languages than any collection of books in the world.
If you take the New Testament and apply it to holy books and any other religion, I don't care what religion you apply it to, there is no question that the New Testament has more data available than any other belief system does. The New Testament has, and critical scholars admit this, the ones who are being, you know, critical of our events, we have more texts, more copies than anyone else. Our copies are earlier than anyone else's. And notice those were two of the criteria that we use in history. Do you have eyewitness texts? Do you have early texts? And a lot of them.
لكن هل الأمر بهذه البساطة؟ ألم يكن هناك مشاكل؟ بإمكاننا جميعاً أن نتخيل عملية الكتابة بخط اليد والنسخ عبر القرون. هذه العملية هي أبعد ما يكون عن أي كمال.
It's not been a perfect process because it's a human process, but there have been so many copies from every century and at times every decade up to the invention of the printing press, when things could be standardized, that where tiny errors crept in, we can determine those and we can correct them.
Because a lot of text allows you to make decisions on individual words, for example.
عندما يجلس الناسخ لينسخ الإنجيل فمن المستبعد أن تكون لديه النسخة الأصلية أي ما يسمى النسخة الأولى للنص. هذا يعني أن النص الذي كان يستخدمه قد يحتوي على بعض الأخطاء. وبما أن الناسخ يكتب بعيداً عن النص الأصلي في المكان والزمان فإن أخطاء النص الذي ينسخ منه قد تكون معقدة إلى حد ما. كمهندس يستعمل مسطرة معوجة حيث يمكن للأخطاء أن تتراكم بشكل كبير، والناسخ أيضاً قد يضيف بعض الأخطاء إلى النص، إضافة لنقل الأخطاء الصادرة عن أسلافه. كيف نفكك هذه العقد التي يسميها العلماء الفروقات النصية؟
If I don't know what word goes in the text over here, it's easier to explain if I have 15 different manuscripts. And they're answering this from different parts of the world and from different times. And we can say, well, these five manuscripts disagree with these two, and the reading should be this. The New Testament measures up better than any other ancient document.
We have church fathers going all the way back to the late first century. We actually have more than 1 million quotations by the church fathers of the New Testament in existence today. It's absolutely astounding, that amount of material.
يبدو أن علماء النص أولاً من خلال تمحيص عشرات الآلاف من مخطوطات الكتاب المقدس القديمة ومن ثم من خلال تمحيص العدد الهائل للاقتباسات التي تدور حول الكتاب تمكنوا من معرفة نص الكتاب المقدس إلى حد كبير. لكن على الرغم من ذلك ما زالت هناك فروقات. السؤال الآن إلى أي مدى يمكن لهذه الفروقات أن تؤثر على محتوى الكتاب المقدس؟
At least 70% of our textual variants are simply spelling differences that affect absolutely nothing. Over 99% of them would fit what I would say are neither viable nor meaningful, or they're both not viable or meaningful. And here's what I mean by this. If it's a viable variant, it means that it could be authentic. It could go back to the original wording. A meaningful variant means it does change the meaning of the text to some degree. I'd say over 99% of our textual variants are neither meaningful nor viable. That's a huge number. It's literally less than 1/5 of 1% of all textual variants are both meaningful and viable. That is, they have a good chance of being authentic, and they do change the meaning of the text to some degree. That's not very many.
الاختلافات في النصوص مع أنها تبدو مثيرة للقلق نراها بعد تفحص دقيق أنها لا تتعارض بشكل مبدئي مع النص. لذلك فإن العديد من نقاد النصوص لديهم قناعة أننا نملك نصاً يمكن الاعتماد عليه.
Many of those differences between the different manuscripts come down to the spelling of a word or to simply one small word that doesn't affect the understanding of the text in a major way. We might think of an example like Deuteronomy 33:2, which says, "The Lord comes from Sinai and he appeared to us." But other manuscripts say he appeared to them. Well, that's not a major issue. But on the other hand, we want to make sure, because we take the Bible seriously as God's word, and because we understand that all scripture is God-breathed and that the very words of scripture communicate God's truth to us, we want to make sure that we are interpreting what the original authors and what the Holy Spirit intended for us.
إن أقل ما يمكن توقعه من كتاب وحيه إلهي هو أن يكون بإمكاننا أن نعتمد على نصه. لكن هذا الكتاب الذي نعتمده تعرض لهجمات كبيرة وقاسية. فمثلاً حين يقول الكتاب المقدس
Utterly destroy, leave alive, nothing that breathes. Where we see man, woman, young and old, even animals who are consigned to judgment, to death, or so it seems.
ماذا يمكننا أن نقول عن هذه الأشياء؟ هل يصور الإنجيل إلهاً يروج للإبادة؟
Well, as we look at the ancient scriptures of Israel, we see that, for one thing, warfare, patriarchy, polygamy, and so forth, these are situations which are not ideal. These are situations which are less than what God would desire. And so God is working within a society of fallen human beings and pointing them, for one thing, to the ideal in Genesis 1 and 2, where we see that all human beings are made in the image of God, male and female, and that marriage is to be between a man and a woman for one lifetime, and that this is to be that there is to be no classism, servant and master and so forth, that all of this is leveled in Genesis 1. But as human societies move forward in history, a lot of these embedded structures where nations have to sometimes defend themselves, or where there are situations of people who are involved in all sorts of horrendous things, God uses those battles and so forth to bring about judgment upon very wicked people. So when we look back at the Old Testament, we need to see these sorts of things as less than ideal, as God basically doing things that grieve Him, rather than seeing these things as the ideal. But let's take a closer look here at what is going on with the Amalekites. They have had a nearly 1,000-year history of antagonism, of hostility, and attempted extermination of the Israelites. From the crossing of the Red Sea and then the attack mentioned in Exodus 17, all the way to the book of Esther, God tells Samuel to tell Saul, Samuel is the prophet, Saul is the king, says to utterly destroy them. It's just a certain pitched battle at a certain city of the Amalekites, and Saul wins the battle, and then the narrator tells us that Saul utterly destroyed them. He left no one alive. But we keep reading that at the end of the book of 1 Samuel, in 1 Samuel 27 and 1 Samuel 30, we see that David is fighting the Amalekites in the same territory that Saul had been fighting. So what we see in the ancient Near Eastern language and war texts is these terms that are used for utterly destroy and so forth, or, you know, again, sometimes it actually doesn't even mean utterly destroy, it just means put out of use.
بالتأكيد هناك أبعاد للكثير من أحداث الكتاب المقدس أكثر مما يمكن للقارئ العادي أن يستنتج. إن الرسالة المحورية والواضحة للكتاب المقدس هي بلا شك العهد الجديد من خلال يسوع المسيح ومجيئه إلى الأرض وموته وقيامته. نقرأ في إنجيل متى: وهذا كله كان لكي يتم ما قيل من الرب بالنبي: هوذا العذراء تحبل وتلد ابنا ويدعون اسمه عمانوئيل، الذي تفسيره الله معنا. البعض اعترضوا على هذه الرسالة والتي تدعى أيضا الخبر الطيب. اعتراضهم كان بشكل خاص على فكرة الموت الكفاري، أي أن يدفع إنسان ثمن جرائم ارتكبها آخر.
The question as to whether it's morally just for Christ to be punished for the sins of the whole human race is a multifaceted question. If Christ served as our representative before God voluntarily, then I think it's difficult to see any injustice in this act. On the contrary, it would be a very noble, self-giving, voluntary sacrifice on Christ's part to die in our place. And if he is not merely our substitute, but actually our representative before God, then insofar as he is punished for our sins, we are punished for our sins. So that our sins are punished in Christ as our representative. And so long as that's undertaken voluntarily on his part, I have difficulty in seeing where the injustice would lie in Christ's taking on my sin and bearing the punishment for it.
لعل الاعتراض هنا ليس على مسألة اللاعدالة، وإنما على ما يرى وكأنه لا مسؤولية أخلاقية. فهل موت المسيح الطوعي عن الإنسان يروج لفكرة أن الأفعال الخاطئة لا يترتب عليها نتائج؟ الكتاب المقدس يوضح لنا ناحية ثانية لموت المسيح تتعدى تلبية العدالة التي يفرضها القانون إلى اعتبار مشكلة البشرية ديناً أخلاقياً. إن فكرة الكفارة بسيطة، يمكن أن نجد مضمونها في هذه الآية من رسالة كولوسي: وإذ كنتم أمواتاً في الخطايا وغلف جسدكم أحياكم معه مسامحاً لكم بجميع الخطايا، إذ محى الصق الذي علينا في الفرائض الذي كان ضداً لنا وقد رفعه من الوسط مسمراً إياه بالصليب.
This is a doctrine in which God himself takes on human flesh and in the person of Christ pays the satisfaction which his own justice had demanded and which we were incapable of paying. And therefore it frees us up to be forgiven and reconciled to God. I don't know of anything else in the world's religions that is comparable to that. And so this is truly, I think, one of the glories of the Christian faith, that God loves us so much that he would stoop down to enter human history and there suffer terribly for our sake and for our redemption, that we might know him and his love forever.
يبدو في الواقع أن هناك مبدأ أسمى يعمل أيضاً من خلال كفارة يسوع. هذا هو: إذ الجميع أخطأوا وأعوزهم مجد الله، متبررين مجاناً بنعمته بالفداء الذي بيسوع المسيح الذي قدمه الله كفارة بالإيمان بدمه لإظهار بره من أجل الصفح عن الخطايا السالفة بإمهال الله. فهذه العطية المجانية تظهر أيضاً أمرين: أولاً، أن بر الله يفوق برنا، ولذلك علينا الاعتماد عليه، كما أن هناك أيضاً ميزة فريدة، الكفارة بيسوع تلغي تفاخر الإنسان. إذ كان يجب علينا أن نعتمد على يسوع كي نتصالح مع الله، إذن يمكننا أن نتجنب ثمن تبرير أنفسنا. لذلك فإن كفارة يسوع هي أبعد ما يكون عن غير اللائق، بل أنها تبدو أكثر الوصايا الأخلاقية التي ترضي القانون الأخلاقي. لنفترض بأي حال أن أحداً ما أراد أن يدفع دينه الأخلاقي بأعمال صالحة، لابد لنا أن نفكر أنها مقايضة فعالة. لكن الكتاب المقدس يقول: وكأنه شاهد حق على تجاربنا، لست أفعل الصالح الذي أريده، بل الشر الذي لست أريده فإياه أفعل. فأني أعلم أنه ليس ساكن في، أي في جسدي، شيء صالح، لأن الإرادة حاضرة عندي، وأما أن أفعل الحسن فلست أجد.
Among medieval theologians, Saint Anselm stands out as arguing that in fact the atonement is necessary for our justification, and he appealed here to God's justice or righteousness. He said, unless God's justice is satisfied, unless the just desert for sin is paid, then God would violate his own nature in simply pardoning sin without some sort of satisfaction. It seems to me that retributive justice does plausibly belong to the very nature of God, his very character, and that therefore for the demands of retributive justice to go unmet would compromise God's moral nature and character. And therefore, atonement through Christ or satisfaction of God's justice is a necessary prerequisite of justification and reconciliation with God.
In an internet world, which as people have said, has domesticated and democratized information, anybody who knows how to set up a blog can consider himself qualified to criticize the Bible, but that doesn't necessarily mean they do or don't know what they're talking about. Even in the scholarly world, by those who have perhaps gone as far as a PhD in specializing in Old or New Testament studies or biblical archaeology or one of the languages used, there is still a fair amount of disagreement because we all bring certain presuppositions, certain prejudices to our study. If one person is strongly a Christ follower, it could be easy for them to overlook or not give enough attention to some of the problems that have been pointed out. And if someone is of another faith or very much skeptical and anti-religion, it's very easy for them to latch on small problems and blow them up and turn them into big ones.
The question arises as to whether empirical sciences and the study of history require methodological naturalism. A good many historians and scientists would think that they do, but that would require some argument in order to support that conclusion. A methodological constraint is just a personal limitation that a particular researcher adopts, and why should he impose his methodological constraint upon anybody else? We'd need some argument, which I haven't seen forthcoming, for why one couldn't do science or history without this self-imposed constraint. As a philosopher, I'm free to postulate any such causes as I think are necessary to explain the effect. So in that case, the historian or the scientist could lead us to the threshold of such a non-natural explanation, but then they would stop and hand the task over to the philosopher to carry it the rest of the way.
عندما يكون السؤال المطروح متعلقاً بمصداقية الكتاب المقدس، من الطبيعي أن يكون لدى البعض افتراضات مسبقة وتحيزات. لذلك لابد من التنبه لوجود هذه الآراء المنحازة والقيام بتمحيصها. كما أنه من الأمانة أن يتراجع السائل عن اعتراضاته عندما تتضح عدم شرعيتها.
If I am not convinced that the supernatural is even a possibility, if I set up a method for studying history and studying literature in which, by definition, anything that I cannot explain scientifically, I have to exclude as impossible, well, then I have no choice but to reject the accounts of miracles in Scripture. But then I should come clean that I am not trying to be as objective as possible. I am allowing my presupposition or my prejudice to influence my results.
I got into apologetics many, many years ago, decades, due to my own doubts. And I was plagued, I think that's a fair word, plagued by doubt for 10 straight years and parts of about 15 more years. And it soon became obvious to me that if the resurrection of Jesus was what the claims were on its behalf, it could answer my primary factual doubts.
It is, in part at least, an act of faith to say we believe these books are uniquely divine in their origin. But it's a matter of historical record to say we can demonstrate the truth of their claims at many, many points.
So instead of arguing for the Bible or thinking that there's one argument that proves the Bible, I like what C.S. Lewis says. I believe the Bible not because I see it as it is, because someone has proved its historicity or something. I believe the Bible because I see everything else in its light. I come to understand myself and other people and the whole world best when I understand it in light of the biblical story. So this is the reason for the hope that is within me. There is light from God's Word, and I see everything else in its light.